Good afternoon. It's an honor to be with you today here at Utah State University. This institution has been an important part of my life since I was a young boy, and I'm honored to be with you today. I'd like to invite you to go with me on a journey of discovery, to see the universe with new eyes. What do I mean by new eyes? Our eyes are sensitive to only a very narrow portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. The wavelengths that are shorter than what we can see are the ultraviolet, the X-rays, and gamma rays. Wavelengths longer than what we can see we call the infrared, microwaves, and radio waves. But they're all part of the same type of energy. We just can't see them with our eyes. But what if we could? That's what I'll show you today. The images you'll see today were made with a telescope. This is a model of the telescope that took these images. And it took in information from the 2.6 to 26 microns out in the infrared. And using that sensor, we can see objects as cold as 70 degrees Kelvin, or 70 degrees above absolute zero. Now, of course, we have to recolor that data back into the visible so we can see it with our eyes. Let me show you how this works. Here I have three identical mugs. One's filled with water at the boiling point, one's filled with water about body temperature, and one's filled with ice water. As you see them here, you're seeing the light that's reflected from the surface, and you really can't tell anything about the temperature from where you're seating. And that's because the color you see is determined by the surface temperature, by the surface chemistry, not the temperature of the object. But what if we could see temperature? Let's bring up the image from this infrared camera. Well, now it becomes very clear. This object on the right is the hot object. The one in the center is very nearly the temperature of my hand, and this one is very cold. So if we can learn through technology to see in heat, we can learn a great deal about the universe, and that's what you're going to see today. But before, one more thing about infrared astronomy, we have to do it from outside the atmosphere. Whereas the atmosphere is quite transparent to the visible light that we see, it's opaque to the infrared. Let me show you an example. This plastic shroud is clearly transparent to visible light, but when I place it over these cups, you can see that it blocks the infrared energy from getting out of the clear plastic. Well, that same thing happens with our atmosphere. We simply can't see the infrared from here on Earth. We have to send the telescopes out into space. So let's go back to our next image. The WISE image, the WISE program stands for Wide Field Infrared Survey Explorer, meaning it's going to map the entire sky in the infrared wavelengths. It's a program funded by NASA. It was led by the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California. The spacecraft, as seen here, was built and designed here at the Space Dynamics Laboratory at Utah State University. And the spacecraft was designed and developed by Ball Aerospace in Colorado. Now, scientists have known for a long time that infrared information about the universe could teach us a good deal about temperature and about the processes going on. So let me show you some of the images that were obtained before the WISE mission. Now, this is an image taken in 1990, not really designed for high resolution, but it gave important astronomical information. An earlier image in 1983 from IRIS gives a little bit better definition. You can see a bright star in the center, some off to the edges, and a little bit of the cloudy structure around the stars. Now, this is the first image that came down from the WISE telescope. And scientists had spent a decade of their life planning and waiting for this mission. They were anxious to see what the WISE telescope would provide in terms of new data. Well, they were not disappointed. Here's what they saw. A million pixels that provided information about the location of the stars, the temperatures, and other information important to the astronomers. Let's look at another example. Here's more IRIS imagery. This shows some bright stars, kind of this cloudy structure in the center, but not really exciting information. With the new eyes of WISE, we get this. Much more information and details about the structure of the clouds, the stars, and the processes that are going on. It's an amazing, beautiful image of the universe. There was a piece of history illuminated by the WISE mission. In 1572, there was a supernova that humans observed because it was bright enough to see in the daytime, and it lasted for about 2 years. It was recorded and chronicled by a Scandinavian astronomer named Tycho. If you look at that patch of the sky today where the supernova took place, it's a pretty ordinary image. But as WISE scanned the universe, the scientists asked, could we see any remnant, any evidence of the Tycho Brahe supernova? Well, in fact, we can. This red object in the lower right is the thermal footprint we can still see today of Tycho's supernova. So, well, Tycho was telling us the truth. This is another nebula, or a cloud-like structure that shows the pretty much what we would see with our eye. As we get out into colder bands, there's a little bit different structure, but as we get into longer wavelengths and colder temperatures, the structure changes quite a bit, and we can see these more cloud-like structure and fewer stars. As we go into the red bands, we see again more cloud-like structure, and the stars kind of fade away. When we combine those into a mosaic, we get this rich kind of carpet of color that we see the things going on in this particular nebula. This is the Heart and Soul Nebula, actually an image taken from Earth in the visible wavelengths, and we can see some of the cloud-like structure because the particles scatter the light from the stars nearby. You're not really seeing the temperature of the object itself. But if we can see with temperature, we can see with a WISE telescope, get a very different picture. We can see much more detail about the structure, and that tells us something about the processes going on. This is a very different kind of structure. This is a thermal bow wave in front of this star that's streaking through the universe at 5 million miles per hour. It's radiating so much energy, it actually heats the particles in space in front of it and creates this massive thermal wave in space. This is a dying star. We can see this energy being radiated away from the star as it goes through the final years of its life. And this is what you can see in the visible. But if we see in the infrared, we see quite a different structure. We see this kind of double halo around the star. And our sun is in this class of star, and this is kind of the way that our sun will end its life a few billion years from now. The hidden galaxy is an interesting image because it can't be seen in the visible range. As the light travels through space, it has to pass through trillions of miles of dust, and the light is simply scattered away and it never reaches our sensors here on Earth. But the infrared wavelengths are longer, and they can traverse and get past the dust better without being scattered. Now let me show you an example of what I mean. Let's come back to our infrared images of the cups, if we could bring that up. You can see clearly the energy from the cups, and here I have a black plastic bag, and as you can see, it doesn't transmit the visible light. But if I place this bag over the cups, you can see that the infrared energy passes right through the plastic. And that's kind of what's happening to the energy traveling across the universe that scatters the light away. So let's come back to our image. We can see the next image of Andromeda. Andromeda is our nearest neighbor. It has about three times the stars of the Milky Way, about a trillion stars, and it's a massive object. If we could see it all, it would be about six full moons wide, just off the plane of the Milky Way. Of course, we can't see it from Earth because of the scattering. It's just too dim. But from space, we get this marvelous image of Andromeda. This is the band closest to what we would see with our eyes. In the cooler bands, the longer wavelengths, we can see these cloud-like structures, and here we see the composite image of Andromeda, our nearest neighbor. Now, if we peer out into the far edge of the universe, we might think it's simply a black void, but WISE told us something different. In this particular patch of sky, through the WISE image, we see this. Clusters of galaxies, each with hundreds of billions of stars, all over the night sky. We simply can't see them, but it just stretches our mind to think how far away they are and how many billions of stars and billions of galaxies exist out in the edges of the universe. Another image, an ultra-luminous infrared galaxy. Now, these are very bright objects. They're about 100 times more radiant than the entire Andromeda galaxy, which is three times that of the Milky Way. And again, these are viewed in the infrared. Some of these objects, they're obscured by the dust, so we have to view them with the infrared energies, and they're called DOGS, which stands for dust-obscured galaxies. Well, scientists, having some sense of humor, realizing how hot they are, had no choice but to call them hot dogs. So we know there are hot dogs in space. WISE has discovered some very cool objects. Well, we call them WISE discovers WISE, and this is a Y-class of brown dwarfs you can see here. There are different kinds of dwarf stars. Now, these are basically failed stars. They collapse into their own gravitational energy. They never reach the temperatures in the center that are necessary to reach thermonuclear fusion and create a bright star like we have in our sun. And WISE found this very cool star in the sense the surface temperature is only about 80 degrees Fahrenheit, just a day on the beach. But to give you an idea how sensitive this telescope is, if you take a piece of that star or a bit of matter about the size of a postage stamp at room temperature, put it out in space and put this telescope 5,000 miles away, it can see the heat from that postage stamp. So exquisitely sensitive instrument. and it's found this new class of brown dwarfs. The WISE sensor also found a host of asteroids and comets. Now, the most interesting one is called the Trojan asteroid. It's called the Trojan asteroid because it's actually hidden in the orbit of the parent planet. And we'd seen these in other planets in our solar system, but one had never been found with Earth until the WISE data revealed that. So we actually have a companion. It's exactly 2 months in front of us in our orbit around the sun. But it's not going in a nice smooth ellipse as the Earth does. It goes in a corkscrew or a helical pattern around its own orbit as it makes its way around the sun. So we have a friend out there clearing the path in front of us every year. Let's take a look at this instrument. Again, I have a mock-up of this instrument here at the side. The energy enters the front of the telescope where it's captured by the main mirror. It's then reflected back to a secondary telescope mirror at the front, and it comes back through a hole in the primary where it's sent to one of these four detectors. You can see some of this information here. This is an example of the focal plane array. This is the sensor or the camera that actually captures the energy and converts it to electrical signals that creates the images that you see. The WISE telescope has four of these sensors, and they cost $2 million each. So we'll be careful with that. The telescope kind of sits up on its end and goes down into this large cryostat whose purpose is to keep the sensor cold. Now you may think, well, space is already pretty cold. Why do you have to cool it? Well, the energy from the sun and the energy from the electronics actually heat it to the point that you cannot use the longer wavelength. So we use solid hydrogen, is launched into space with the sensor, and it keeps it down to 5 to 7 degrees Kelvin, so it's very cold. We have to do that so it doesn't see its own heat. And so we're able to put that sensor together and then calibrate it. The calibration is important because we need to have scientifically credible data for comparison years and decades from now. Here you can see the WISE telescope being calibrated at our laboratory, where each one of those million pixels on all four focal planes is calibrated individually for linearity and responsiveness. With that data, we can take the raw data from the telescope and convert it into absolute physical measurements that will have meaning for years to come. Here we see the sensor atop the spacecraft, which provides the telemetry, the steering, the radio transmissions, and so on. And on the right, you can see the sensor sitting atop the rocket just prior to its launch. The WISE was launched in the middle of December of 2009 from the Vandenberg Air Force Base in California. Just a beautiful morning and a perfect launch, and it's been just an amazing and successful mission. These images of the universe and these rich and vibrant colors have changed my view of the universe. It's not just this dark stage where the characters are just points of light that carry out this dark cosmic drama. If we could see all the energy that's out there, as we see here, it's a lot more like an action movie. I mean, there's exploding stars, there's dying stars, there's new ones being born. We have character actors. I mean, we've got brown dwarfs. We have Trojan asteroids, and, well, we even have hot dogs. Now, you may be asking yourself, if this is really an action movie, is there a superhero around to take the starring role? Well, WISE has found evidence of one with this, the helmet of Thor. Now, if Thor is out there, he is a big guy, because that helmet is 30 light years across. And that star in the middle is 200,000 times brighter than our sun. Let's end our journey today by coming back to our galactic home, the Milky Way. This amazing image is a composite of the Milky Way as viewed from Earth. You can see the interesting structure where stars are being born and stars die, and the very bright center of the Milky Way, where it's believed to be a massive black hole. Over time, we have learned how to, through science and technology coupled with human determination and curiosity, we've learned how to cross the continents, sail over the oceans, fly through the air, and journey out into space. But I think each of those journeys of discovery outward is part of a journey of discovery inward. That was expressed well by T.S. Eliot when he wrote, "We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of our exploring will be to arrive where we started and to know the place for the first time." I hope that you've enjoyed this journey of discovery with me today. I hope, too, that this journey outward may be part of a journey inward, that we might see ourselves, our neighbors, our nations, our amazing planet with new eyes and come to know them in new ways. If we could make those discoveries, I think those would be the most important ones of all. Thank you.